So welcome everyone to the 3-minute thesis competition. This competition was part of the student meet last month and had to be postponed because we did not get enough participation because the communication wasn't circulated to all the students. So we decided to hold it at a later stage with the consent of the judges, of course. And we are really happy that we've had students now participate from different departments. And it's glad that all of you could make it today and you've put in so much effort to be part of this competition. In this competition, we at the moment have 3 participants. And the rules of the competition are such. Imaya, if you could change the slide, please. There's only one static slide that will be used by the participants. There'll be no slide transition, animations or anything. There'll be just one fixed slide. No additional props will be used. Keeping the video on will be preferred. Duration of the presentation is, of course, as the name suggests, only 3 minutes. Presentations are considered to have commenced when the presenter starts the presentation. So I will display your slides that you have shared with us, and I will give you a prompt that you can begin, after which at 3 minutes, again, I will give you a prompt where you can stop your presentation. And that this decision will be taken by the 2 judges who are here today, who I will introduce shortly. We also have a pre-planned rubric for this competition, which judges the participants on the slide that they have used, how they have made use of the slide in terms of their research method and all the other sections, how have they folded together, and how is it useful for the presentation when they make. We will also be judging participants on the coherence of the use of the methodology, the research question, how they have organized it and displayed it and communicated in the next 3 minutes. There was a rubric prepared for this, which was shared with the participants as well as the judges, so that the whole process is very transparent. And this rubric, we also discussed with our judges who are here today, Dr. Poonam Sharma. She's an assistant professor at the Center for Teacher Excellence, formerly known as the Center for Education, Innovation and Action Research. She's a teacher educator and an ethnographer. Before joining her current position, she has worked as a teacher educator in pre-service teacher education, as well as NGO sector. She began her career as a primary school teacher. Her PhD research was a year-long ethnographic work focusing on the educational experiences of children in the context of the family-school relationship. The study was based in a small town close to Delhi. The study brought together the new sociological perspectives on children, childhood, and ethnographic equities for understanding families and schools. Her research was supported by the NCERT. She received also the DAD's Student Exchange Program Fellowship for the year 2010. And thank you, Poonam, for being with us and also coordinating through all the changes in the program. So we are very thankful for your participation and of course, judging this competition with us. Next, we also have Dr. Meera Chandran. She's an assistant professor at the Center for Education, Innovation and Action Research, which is now Center for Teacher Excellence. She has worked extensively in education and development sectors for nearly 20 years. She teaches master's courses in teacher education, education development and policy, as well as research methodology. Her research interests lie in sociology and political economy of education. She's currently working on areas of social equity in urban schooling and student livelihood aspirations, ICT in education, political economy of teaching. She has led many research projects, designed and conducted numerous workshops and research seminars for professionals in the education sector. She is a research lead currently on the center's Connected Learning Initiative, a multi-award-winning ICT business, and also a co-PI for the Government of India's SparkClick project for conducting research, design workshops, as well as case studies. So thank you, Meera, for being part of this process. And also bearing with us with all the changes in the schedule. We're very thankful for your participation.
My pleasure. Thank you.
As you can see through the profiles of the judges, they both have, we have a variety of interests that the judges have. They are both expertise in qualitative as well as quantitative research, so that it helps the judge, so it sort of helps weigh in different kinds of research that the participants might present. So thank you very much. As I begin, I will now display the slide of the first participant, which is Urvi Bhomik. He's a master's student at the Center for Development Studies at TIS. Hi, Urvi. Good to see you. Just give me a moment before I display your slide.
Yeah, sure.
So, Urvi, I'll give you a prompt and then you can start your presentation.
Right.
Your time starts now.
So, hello, everyone. I hope I'm clearly audible. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to present here, and I'm very glad to be here. I'm Urvi Bhaumik, studying MA Development Studies at the School of Development Studies at TIS Mumbai, and I'm working for my dissertation under Professor Vikambara Hebbar. I'm working on the question of sociality amongst migrant women. So my research in a way stems from my personal experiences, because the first time that I myself became a migrant was when I stepped out of my home to go and study at TIS. And I explored and I saw how my everyday interactions were really helping me to build ties that helped me get through circumstances that were otherwise very difficult for a person who's out of her home for the first time in a stranger city. So I then wanted to take this forward in academic research, and when I entered the field, I saw that migrant women were being perceived in a very passive sense, and negative aspects of their lives were being highlighted. But I wondered, what about their agency? What about their everyday lives, which is in which they themselves negotiate continuously with the structures they face? And in that sense, what about the solidarity networks that they build that helps them to negotiate the difficult situations they find themselves in? So my major research questions then are, one, I want to explore the nature of sociality in migrant women's lives. Sociality is a sociological, anthropological concept which explores the everyday fabric of social interactions in people's lives. I want to explore this in the context of migrant women's lives. And I also want to relate it to how these migrant women then relate to different power structures, patriarchy and gendered power structures being at the core of my thesis. I have mostly employed a qualitative research methodology. I've looked at in-depth interviews with migrant women, I've conducted them. I've also documented their talk and interactions on an everyday basis, and that has related to, it's in the line of the ethnomethodological tradition, that is a research tradition in sociology, is exploring the concept of everyday interactions. And I've also employed narrative analysis to understand the themes that emerge from the stories that these migrant women tell about themselves. So in this respect, I just want to end with the fact that I'm at the final stage of my dissertation, writing about the findings that I have, and they're very interesting because it shows me how the sociality amongst migrant women, and I'm studying migrant women in Kolkata, it allows them to not only develop ties that help them to find work opportunities and help them to bear up against power structures, but it also becomes the site of building and constructing a sense of self, a sense of identity for themselves that helps them to get through an everyday and a life that is otherwise very difficult. So I plan to
continue.
Your
time's up, Urvi.
Yeah, so that was it. So yeah, thank you. I just wanted to say that I plan to continue with this further in my research. Questions would be welcome. Thank you.
So thank you, Urvi. And also thanks for, responding to all the emails and other queries that you've been sending us through the email. So thanks for your engagement. The next participant in the competition is Rishikesh. He's a PhD scholar at the School of Social Work. Hi, Rishikesh.
Hi.
Let me just share the slide and then I'll give you a prompt, right? So Rishikesh, your time starts now.
Yeah, good morning. So the title of my slide is Pedagogic Practices in Work-Centric Education. Do you remember when you were in schools and the teacher came into your classroom, asked you to take out your science textbooks, open to chapter number 6, human body, page number 32, paragraph number 2, topic, human digestive system. And didn't you feel, oh, just another day in the class, I wish this chapter was easy to study for the exams. And when the teacher was actually teaching, you were waiting for the lunch break because you had bought your favorite Maggi noodles or paratha made by your mother. This is such an ordinary scenario that we don't really feel anything odd about it. But in actuality, it shows that for the child, learning in school is useful only for exams, or it matters only within the four walls of the classroom. It has absolutely nothing to do with life outside the school, life at home, and the problems that he faces in day-to-day life. Before my PhD and MPhil, I was working exactly on this problem. How can we make education an authentic experience for the child? How can we engage children in real life activities that actually matters to them beyond textbooks and beyond exams? And during this time, I came across Gandhi's philosophy of Nayi Taleem, which is an education philosophy that aims to teach using through the medium of real life productive work or occupations. Occupations such as gardening, cooking, cloth work, tailoring, and so on. And India actually tried to implement this kind of education throughout the country, but we failed. We failed pathetically. And not just in India, similar education efforts have failed across the world. And I was wondering, how can such a beautiful idea fail over and over again? So to answer these questions, I decided to do my PhD qualitative research. And I decided to study Gandhi's Nayi Taleem School in Sevagram and find out what exactly is happening in this particular school. How are the teachers teaching using occupational activities? How are the children learning through this kind of approach? And what are the main reasons that stop such a beautiful idea from spreading on a large scale? I did observations of children when they were working in the farms, when they were doing tailoring, when they were spinning. I listened to the conversations happening between the teachers and the children. I also observed the subject classes of science and mathematics and how exactly teachers are connecting the work activities and the subject classes. I interviewed teachers to understand what are their what are the challenges that they are facing. I interviewed children and parents to understand their perspective on such kind of education. And based on the findings, I hope that we are able to work on reviving such kind of education system in future, and where the teacher will teach human digestive system not based on a chapter in the textbook, but based on based on what you have bought in your lunchbox, which you have prepared by yourself as part of your classwork. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishikesh.
Yeah.
The next participant for the competition is Manoj Kumar. Manoj, if you can turn on your camera if it's possible, be nice to see you. Okay. So I'm just going to share your slide at the moment, and I'll give you a prompt after that. Right? So Manoj, I have shared your slide, and okay. Your time starts now.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Manoj Kumar. I am pursuing PhD in the School of Social Work. The title of my dissertation is Constructing Women Identity and Their Choices of Academic Discipline in Higher Education. I am doing this research under the supervision of Dr. Vaishali Kohli. So the essence of my research topic is very simple. We can imagine that we are standing in the market and lots of goods and services are available in the market, and we have to choose which one is best for us. Suppose if I'm going to the shop of umbrella and I have to purchase one best umbrella, I have to reject all of them while choosing one or two umbrella out of many. So after buying these umbrella, one or two, if one umbrella is not good condition, I can return the umbrella. So this is the scenario of market. When we come into the context of higher education, we are seeing commerce, science, engineering, lots of discipline are scattered here and there. And students has to choose, first of all, students has to understand what his or her interest is. Later on, based on his or her interest, he has to choose the interested or the desirable academic discipline. So when we come into the context of women, we know very well that hierarchy and patriarchy are ubiquitous in the society, and it is needless to say that the condition of women is more vulnerable in the comparison of men, meaning I can say that women are not free to choose the academic discipline as men are free. And it is like, as in the education, we can see the context of hidden curriculum, like this is also many times hidden or many times not hidden. So basically, this research is dealing the question, how women interest develop, and what are the dilemma of women students when they select or reject any academic discipline while taking admission in higher education. This research is also dealing the questions.
Manoj, sorry, your time's up.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Manoj, Rishikesh, and Urbi. May I please request the judges, if they want to share just general comments at the moment before they decide to get into a discussion to discuss the winner. Dr. Poonam and Dr. Meera, any general comments?
Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So nothing about the content I would want to comment. I would just comment about the structure of the presentation. So when we make presentation in such a like a short span, which has to be very crisp, we have to be very, very judgmental about the time we are giving to our own introduction and the way we divide the time between background of the research and coming to the main question and the methodology. So it's very, very important that we structure the time accordingly and try to reduce our own introduction to the minimum, because I think the anchor is already introducing us. So maybe that thing is something that could have been avoided. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Poonam.
I just wanted to say that I tried my best to read the content of Manoj's slide, but I really could not. I tried to zoom in, but I could not read. The text was very tiny. So maybe you can share it offline. We can take a look at it. I don't know about Poonam, but I certainly couldn't read anything on the slide.
Sure. Thank you, Meera.
Yeah. Even I could read parts of it. The last few sentences are very, very.
I think we can. Thanks for those general comments. I think definitely one needs to be mindful of those. Maybe we should have a longer discussion after you've had your discussion among yourselves. And may I please request Imaya, who's a student representative, to also be part of the discussion with the two judges. If a phone call is necessary, please coordinate it through a personal message on Zoom itself. It's about 10:57 now. How much time do you think that, you could go over, but generally what is the time that you might require, if I may ask the judges?
I think we need about 10, 15 minutes.
Sure, sure. So I think we could say about 11:10 or 11:15, right?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. Please feel free to drop off the call and join again. In the meantime, it'll be really helpful if the participants who prepared for this presentation and the audience who are there as observers, if you have any questions for the participants who prepared for it, let's use this forum for that time. Because we had a lot of interested participants who wanted to be part of the competition, but they were uncertain as to how what is the process of preparing a presentation for such a short time. So I think given that they've tried this out, please feel free to ask them any questions, also pertaining to their research itself. You can just unmute yourself and ask, or on the chat itself. Okay, so before the audience takes their time and asks any question, I do have a question for all three of you. How is it like preparing for a competition like this? Have you participated for something like this before? Urbi, Rishikesh, Manoj, any of you?
Hi, so no, I haven't participated in anything of this earlier because I'm in my master's now, and I did do a bachelor dissertation for my bachelor's, but this is a novel to me, and it did sound exciting to me, and it did. I think the very essence and the meaning of it really appealed to me, because one is that I think in academics we're used to writing long, but how to present the material we have in a way that's crisp and that's presented simply in a very short manner that does not require long attention spans, and also because one has to simplify one's own research, which is what I saw in the links and the references that you sent as examples, that one has to present it in a manner that's accessible to everyone. And I think that's a very important factor that needs to be brought in academic pursuits, that we don't do it just for the sake of doing it, but we do it also so that it gets disseminated to larger audiences. So there's these points really appeal to me. So yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Urubi. Manoj, Rishikesh, any comments on what either Urubi said or anything else that you want to highlight?
Yeah, even for me, this was a very interesting competition. I have not heard of it before, and then I was not sure whether I should participate or not. And but the idea was exciting, because if you are able to communicate your research in simple language and in a short time, that means you have understood it clearly. And it's also helpful to explain to a new person in a simple language. Yeah. It's a skill in itself, I think we all should develop. Otherwise we get too much technical, and we cover very limited area of audiences when we go in a very technical language. And the videos that you had on the links of the YouTube video that you have put, that were, I saw that, and then I really liked the way they, the participants had covered their topic in 3 minutes. I mean, it encouraged myself, so that even if I can do such a brief presentation. I mean, I was excited on at my personal level. So I think I thought I should give a try to such a competition. And yeah, and thank you for you as an organizer as well for organizing such an event. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Rishikesh, for participating. It's, as you highlighted, it's certainly a skill to inculcate. In fact, that was the entire motive of the competition, to make research accessible and find ways to, first of all, make it accessible in our own heads.
Yeah.
Before we do it outside in the world. So thanks. Manoj?
Yeah. I also like this idea very much, because presenting thesis in 3 minutes is a good idea, and it is not very easy, but we have to make the work very easy, because we not only have to make understand about our research to our research guide or to the professors and all, like if we get opportunity to make common people understand about our research, and suppose if we get opportunity to make a child of 8-year-old understand about the PhD thesis and all. So like, which kind of language we have to use in order to make him or her understand? So 3 minutes, 4 minutes and 2 minutes, you know, it's very good idea, and I like it very much. And if I tell you a little bit, yesterday night, approximately 7 or 6 o'clock, I got to know about this competition. I did not lose this opportunity, meaning I did not want to lose this opportunity. Meaning I have learned a lot after presenting my research in front of you within 3 minutes. I like it very much. Thank you so much to the organizer who gave me opportunity and who allowed me to present my thesis. Thank you so much.
Manoj, we should just thank you for your enthusiasm or preparing the presentation just overnight. So thank you for your enthusiasm. We've been trying to motivate students to be part of it, but doing it at the last moment, I think that really needs congratulations. Thank you. We had Meera engage with Urvi on the chat, and she's been answering questions there. If you want to take time to read the chat as well. Are there any other questions that the audience have? I wanted to ask all three of you that what was the motivation around even choosing a topic? That's always been difficult. I think some people are always curious in terms of, because they have so many interests on topics, how do you actually go about choosing a research topic? And how did you narrow down your own research topic?
For myself, I think first came the question of migrant women, and that is something that I said in the presentation, that my own experiences of migration and how I saw it really made me wonder about how a migrant life is. And this is also because I come from a sociological background. So for me to, I wanted to explore this idea of, because migrants sort of fallen through the cracks that exist in society, because a society is more static, imagined in static terms, but migrants is about flows and mobilities. So I wanted to explore what development has to offer people who you cannot imagine in static terms. And then I also wanted to explore the question of the everyday life, because that is something that has always fascinated me. How everyday life gets mapped out in people's social lives as well as the greater society. So it's bringing these two things together. Migration also was a development concern, and bringing the sociological concept of sociality and trying to explore these two together, where they met and where when they meet, what kind of dynamics are produced, with a larger feminist research framework. So that is what
So basically, the recent migrant crisis, is that also the motivation behind this, or this was an interest long time back?
The recent migrant crisis happened in 2020, and I've been pursuing this from 2019, because that is when we had to articulate our research interests and we had to submit our proposals for the dissertation. So I've been pursuing that, and in fact, definitely I would factor in the effects of COVID and all of it, but COVID isn't what I'm exploring when I'm exploring the migrant crisis necessarily. It relates to aspects of their lives which have always been present for migrant women. So,
Because I was paying attention to the time than your presentation, have given part of the facilitation process, I didn't pay attention whether your data was already collected or that is something that you did this year during the COVID crisis itself. So in case you did collect any data during the COVID crisis, how difficult it was collecting data and, you know, just getting in touch with migrants generally.
Interestingly, my field at first I had chosen my field to be Mumbai. So I wanted to explore the experiences of Bengali migrant women in Mumbai. But I had to come off. We were supposed to do our dissertation fieldwork in April 2020. And that was when, before that, the lockdowns happened and everything. So everything went berserk. But gradually in the next semester, when we got the semester break around December, we were told that secondary literature could be the main source, but if possible, we could go about doing interviews. And I was based in Kolkata, because that's my hometown. So what I thought is, maybe I should shift my field here. And I had not been able to start any field work there anyway. So I tried to think of ways of interviewing migrant women here. And that is showing up very exciting results, because I interviewed Bihari migrant women. I interviewed Bengali rural to urban migrant women. And then also migrant women from the Northeast. And the different dynamics that each of these migrant women have faced, and how the sociality between these groups, as well as, for example, the sociality between Bengali migrant women and Bengali middle-class female employers, how that is also very important. So all of these I've been able to do it. So I did my field work mostly around December 2020, and I've been continuing it by bits, taking a couple of interviews here and then when I can, because now we have our classes going. But yeah, so
this has been mostly distant or in person, or how has been the data collection during the COVID, little bit that you've done?
No, I went and talked to them. It was face to face, because we do have a lot of migrant women around here. They are employed in they possibly iron clothes. That's a business they have, or maybe there are migrant men who have shops, and so I interviewed their wives. So it has been face to face, not telephonic, not distant. So I've been to their places and interviewed. At times I've invited them over to my place. So the place is what they get to choose. And I've simply been there and interviewed. There's been participant observation. At times there have been group discussions in which I've participated too. So
Thanks for sharing that. Rishikesh,
yeah.
How did you choose your research? And also during the COVID, if you collected any data, how was that process?
No, my data collection was before COVID itself. And how did I choose my research? I have a social work background, and I jumped into education. One reason was my own educational experience in school, which I was very much unsatisfied about. And when after my social work, then I actually got a fellowship from TIS, and I was working with children in a rural area. I was teaching them. I was trying to devise my own education methods. I had some ideas of my own of how we can make education more meaningful to the children. And I spent around 2 years. And then I decided to do my MPhil into education itself to gain a more theoretical understanding of the field of education. And when I was in MPhil, then I got the Lalit Lama Fellowship, where I had my own center in Mumbai, near Govindi. So I did some more experiments in education with children. And during that time also, we used to make science-based toys, especially we used to make them, which I used to understand the science behind these toys. And then during this time, I came across this Gandhi's Netali philosophy, and I was really impressed, and I could really see that the ideas that were there in this philosophy of Netali closely matched with my own ideas. So, but since, like I said, it has failed across the country drastically. And so that was the motivation to try to understand this method, this kind of school. So fortunately, there was one Netali school still running in Wardha. So I thought, even for my own personal level, I wanted to understand how such kind of education is going on in school. And since I was working in education with children also, I wanted to innovate my own teaching, own methods. So I thought maybe I can learn, along with my research, I can learn some new innovative ways of education through this school. So that's why I chose this topic. And I did my data collection long back, in fact, 2018 itself. And now I'm still in the analysis phase. I'm in the writing stage as of now.
So was the center, since you said you have a center in Govindi, was the center also running during the COVID period, and what were the challenges?
I did it in MPhil. So I was in MPhil in 2013-15. So that center ran from 2 years, 2014 to 2016. So it was very long back ago, but that experience, and when I was working in rural area before my MPhil, it was back in 2012-13. These experiences that I had with children, they were very crucial to develop my ideas into education, and then decide what exactly I want to research about.
Thanks for sharing that, Rishikesh. Manoj?
Hello.
Hi, we can hear you. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. If I tell you people about the motivation behind choosing this research, I want to go into my childhood. When my elder brother was trying to choose science in his undergraduation after completing 12th class. And I think it was 2001 or 2002, he secured approximately 45% marks in 12th standard. Because of his merit, he was unable to choose his interested discipline. So when he took arts, so he was not very happy while choosing humanity. And I thought at that time, meaning I was very young, my age, like I was approximately, 14, 15 years old at that time. But I felt that this situation is not only related to my brother, but also this situation is lead to many students and maybe female students or male students. Whenever I get opportunity to have words with the student studying in 8th standard or 10th standard, when I was in B, I'm talking about at that time. So children, students were not aware what BA is, what BCom is, what BSc. In their simple words, they used to say BA meaning 13th, 14th, 15th, 13th, 14th, 15th. BCom meaning 16th, 17th, 18th, Solvi, Satri, Atharvi. BSc meaning 19th, 20th, 21st. So going on. So meaning if in 10th standard or 9th standard, if they are not aware what BA, BCom, BSc is, so how will they be able to understand what their interest are, or how will they be able to choose their desirable discipline in our education? So meaning when I joined MPhil in 2014 in Tata Institute of Social Sciences, I basically took this topic as my research, took this issue as my MPhil dissertation, and I did, meaning I expanded the dissertation in my PhD and I took it. I would also like to say that in 2010, while my master in TISS, I got fellowship, 1 year fellowship from Ashoka Youth Venture, and I implemented the same idea in orphanages like Baal Bhaiya orphanages and Baal Anand orphanages situated in Chembur. And in 2011, I had been awarded fellowship, a 2 year fellowship from Adelkive Foundation. So I implemented the same project in Delhi, like Salam Balak Trust or St. Stephen Dispensary and Aman Biradri. These were the NGO. And in 2014, meaning I thought that this topic need to be studied a lot, because it is very students are facing lots of problems and they are very much confused and they are unable to choose their desirable discipline. Therefore, I chose this topic in my MPhil and PhD. And if I tell you a little bit about COVID period, actually, as I told you that meaning I basically conduct workshops on passion development, meaning with the help of different therapies, activities, riddles, I teach to the student about the passion evolution. Meaning with the help of activity, I also teach them how they can draw their passion from within. So I basically conducted online classes on Google Meet. I conducted the workshop and seminar on passion development, and students from Delhi, Bombay, Madhya Pradesh, meaning throughout various parts of India, they joined, and few of them were visually challenged also, and many of them were sighted students. So while conducted this the workshop on passion development, we have also conducted the workshop on understanding others' passion with the help of their interview, or we can say focus group discussion. If we are planning to talk to 3-4 person at a time, so at the time we used to use focus group discussion, and if we are talking to one a person while understanding his or passion, so we used to use interview method at that time. So we did that also, and my experience is very good, and the classes, the workshops is still going on. These students are still in touch with me, and I would like to tell you that last thing, from 3rd April 2021, I am going to start new batch for the workshop of passion development. Students are very enthusiastic, and it's a 3-month certificate course, and it's an online course. If you see any student is confused, like he or she is not able to understand what BABCOM is, so we are providing that online platform. And the target group is students who are studying above 8th standard, 9th to 12th, after undergraduation or post-graduation, any course. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you. I think you've highlighted a very important issue. I think some of us who live in urban areas, I think we take it for granted the amount of social capital that is available around us. In the sense of information that we receive just about living in a city. And I myself live in a small town. I live in Warangal at the moment. And I can the little amount of interaction that I have with children in my own locality, it's very obvious that the worldview of the children needs to be expanded much more. There needs to be much more access to information and knowledge. I think it's taken for granted that internet provides all of this, but even what do you look for internet also comes from your interest and passion that needs to be expanded in the first place so that students go out and look for other things. So thank you for highlighting that issue. I think it's really important. We had some question and chat with the participants in the chat window itself. So do keep looking for that. Any other questions? From the participants, you can also unmute yourself and engage.
Hi, Ekta, Chitra here.
Hi, Chitra. Go ahead.
I want to ask from Rishikesh that he said he went to the school of Naitali. What were your findings there? And you said it failed. So I know like certain things about Naitali and what motive it has. So can you like talk a little more about it?
Yeah, thank you for the question. So it failed in terms of a large scale implementation in India, but this particular school is still running, and at present it is difficult to call it a fully Naitalian school because they follow two parallel curricula. They follow the state board syllabus also, the Maharashtra state board syllabus, and where they do all the subject classes, science, mathematics, history, geography, and all that. And then secondly, they follow the Naitalian curriculum where they where the children do farming, they do cooking, they do spinning. They have some cloth work activities like tailoring and embroidery like that. So so what happens because of this two parallel curricula, it becomes really difficult to integrate both of them. They run parallel to each other, and the idea and even the school tries to attempts to integrate both of both these two curricula, but in practice it really becomes difficult. In the when the children are working, they will work, and the children and the teachers will try to connect it with their textbooks. For example, if they are say doing the farming, the teachers will try to connect it, like how the plants grow, why the leaves look green, what is photosynthesis, what are types of fruits and all that. But when they are in the classroom, I realize that it is a very textbook-centered activity. Occasionally, they might connect the classroom teaching with their work activities, their gardening, cooking, and all that. But it is not as frequent. And I still found that the disconnection between the Naitalian curriculum and the subject curriculum was still there intact. And I feel that until and unless we have these two parallel curriculum and then try to integrate it externally, it becomes a very artificial mechanical approach. We need something which is one and the same. We don't want these two kind of curriculum. And still in the analysis process, it's a bit of very complicated. It's not really, I need for analysis. That's why I didn't put analysis part also, because still it's in the working stage.
Thank you for your response. And I feel that it must be difficult for both students and the teacher to cope up with both things that is going on.
Yes. And because of this disconnection, it gets a vocational kind of inclination. The parents think that it's a vocational activity for its own sake. The parents don't really understand that how it is linked to their other academic learning. So, and since it's a rural area, it kind of matlab chal jata hai kind of wahan pe. But I really wonder if it was in a urban area, how parents would have responded to such kind of activities.
But even though the skills that they are developing, is that a problem for a rural place to adopt?
Sorry?
I mean skills that they are developing through that model. Why is it difficult for the parents not to accept that? I mean, it's okay if they have getting the some vocational trainings and all.
They do accept it. They don't accept it at all. In fact, at least those who have admitted their child to their this particular school, they accept it certainly, but they don't see it as connected with their other academic subjects. They feel it is on its own sake. So they think that through farming, that teacher and the children will learn to grow crops. Through cooking, that they think that the child will learn to cook, but they don't understand that through cooking, the child will also learn to understand science in a more practical way. He can understand mathematics in a more practical way. That kind of understanding is not there among parents. Only few parents, I would say, who are very educated, who understand the nuances of this approach.
Thank you, Rishikesh. It was really helpful.
Thank you. I think we have the, so thank you first of all to all the participants for engaging in this discussion. I think the small number of participants has helped us sort of engage with their research and ask them more questions. I think that's the benefit sometimes of a smaller group. So thank you very much for the participants and the presenters for this engagement. We have the three judges as well as the student representative back. I think everybody has been waiting for the results so far. So I would request the judges, Meera as well as Poonam, to first probably share the criteria and the things that went into deciding the winners, and then probably share the winners with us. Thank you so much.
Poonam, would you like to go?
Yeah, in terms of, I just wanted to make a few comments before we talk about the criteria, etc. I believe that all these kinds of events that we participate in are only one of the ways to help us polish our own skills and abilities. So I think that is the spirit within which we should take this. And it's always very difficult to be, you know, in the position of judging such events, because these are very, very tough decisions to make, and they're very, in many ways, are very subjective, and also depend on what is the area you're dealing with and what are the rules of the game that you're playing with. So that's the comment I wanted to make. And I think in such competitions, it is really important to stick to that one criteria that defines the event. So for example, it was about 3 minutes that were being given to you. So one has to be really, really, that is the topmost priority, to keep it to 3 minutes and structure the time very well. So I think that's what is important to consider while presenting for such things. Yeah. Meera, you can talk about the criteria, and then we can announce the results.
Yeah, I think Poonam said it very well. So the spirit in which we should take this I think it's a very good, I must first congratulate the idea that went into creating this kind of event itself in the first place. So I think a lot of thinking and effort has gone into designing it really well, and it has been very nicely and thoughtfully conducted. So I must congratulate you first for doing that. And secondly, as Poonam rightly mentioned, these are opportunities that are, I think, probably not available for students in the social sciences in particular. This is my own personal view, as well as I think it can be supported by the evidence that we see in terms of opportunities that students of social sciences get as compared to students in the natural sciences. The second point that I wanted to make is, again, to supplement what Poonam is saying, when we talk about presenting our research, and this happens to all of us, when put on the stage, because we spend so much of our time and energy engaging with the rationale and the background and the literature and the theories that inform our own research, we tend to focus a lot more on those aspects rather than what the audience is really interested in hearing about, which is what I have to say, what I have to contribute to this field, and what do I have to say about this particular research question. So this is an important lesson that we all of us learn by making all these kinds of mistakes. So I think that is also a kind of turn in focus. People are actually interested in what I have to say rather than what I have learned. That is something that we learn the hard way. So that is also something that I just wanted to emphasize. The third point that I wanted to make, and this again relates to the first point that I made about the difference between social sciences and natural sciences. This is a training that students in the natural sciences often get, which is, in the given space, how do you represent your own thinking, the work, the concepts that you have engaged with, the processes that have gone into it, and presenting it in an interesting manner. So there is something called a poster presentation that is part of conferences very much so in the natural sciences, but slowly it is happening in the social sciences also, that, you know, within a given, just this one slide that we all got opportunity to present, how do you use that space in order to be able to represent your work in a more interesting manner? So this is also something that comes with these kinds of opportunities and the practice that we get to be able to do so. So I think that is the spirit in which I would take this kind of opportunity that has been given to us in this case and learn from this and maybe get better and better at doing this as you go along in your research journey. Yeah.
Thanks, Meera and Poonam. I think we're also now waiting with anticipation about the winners of the competition. So any one of you would like to take the opportunity, please go ahead.
Yeah. All right. So let me just open the sheet. I think Urbe had made the presentation in terms of the background and in terms of the layout of the presentation. The space was very well used, and the connection amongst the rationale, the aims of the study and the questions and methodology were very well placed. So Urbe has scored 18 in the total in the presentation. Rishikesh presented well in terms of the methodology, in terms of the background that was set for the research question that that he had to present. And then the connection between the background and the research question, we thought there was some lag that still needs to be, I'm sure he's reading a lot around these things, but the connection had to be made much more explicit and much more clear in terms of theoretical framework that were governing the research question. So those are the, and also in terms of the use of the space of the slide that was being presented. So Rishikesh has obtained 14.5 as an average. Manoj, of course, we would like to hear more about your presentation because your research area is something that interests both of us. But unfortunately, I think you didn't get time to finish your presentation fully. And that's also like one way that made it difficult for us to really mark you on the presentation. But definitely you had set the background very well in terms of the research questions and trying to connect the research question with the example that you were taking up. We had a look at your slide as well afterwards. So I think we've been trying to see the connections that you've made, but you couldn't really use the time appropriately in terms of structuring the background and the key question that you had to focus. So Manoj had actually obtained 13 as an average mark. Yeah, Meera, would you want to add anything?
Yeah, no, I don't want to add anything. Just to say congratulations to all three of you. I think it takes a lot of guts to come and present it in this kind of manner, particularly in this kind of an online mode. So I really congratulate all three of you. And I'm sure all of these that we pointed out are things that you are already thinking about. It's just that in the pressure of 3 minutes, what do we prioritize? So I think that is the most important element that we have scored you on. It's not really the any reflection on whether or not this element is there in your research. I'm sure these are things that you are already thinking about in a very deep manner.
Thank you very much, Poonam and Meera, for such a detailed conversation around the rubric. And taking so much time to also sharing your feedback on the presentation. I think that's definitely going to be very helpful. So did the judges decide whether there's just one winner or two winners according to the scoring? Imaya, if you could also, if you want to.
No, we haven't decided whether it's one or two. We, like what Meeran and Poonam, what would you say? Can we go with two prices?
Sure. So in that case, Urvi as well as Rishikesh, congratulations very much. As stated in the form earlier, the first cash prize was about 3,000 rupees and the second prize was 1,500. We will get in touch with you to share, if you can share the bank details with us so we can transfer the amount to you directly. We will do it via email. But thank you very much. Please, if you have any questions for the judges, feel free to talk to them. Let's take this time to do that.
I just wanted to record my thanks. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for the very valuable comments and feedback. I'll try and I've definitely jotted them down. And I would love to know the feedback specifically on my presentation. Is there anything that Professor Chandran or Professor Poonam would like to say? I would love to know.
So I had a question right after your presentation about the what you mentioned regarding the patriarchy. You mentioned the power structures. And also right in the beginning when you presented your background and rationale, you drew a autobiographical connection between how you came into the city and as a migrant. So I was wondering if you would also be able to reflect on any differences you see between the way you see yourself as a migrant and how someone who's coming into the city to work would see themselves as a migrant. So that was first question. And the second one was, I mean, you don't have to answer it. This is just since you asked. The second one, which I did wonder about, was pertaining to how you were framing the question of power and patriarchy. And in the Indian context, if you would be able to reflect on whether that's the only aspect that contributes to the power structure, or are there any intersectionalities that one has to also pay attention to? Yeah, those are the two things.
Yeah. Do I respond or do I wait for Professor Poonam Sharma? I'm so sorry.
No, I don't have any question as such. You can go ahead with answering Meera's.
I would suggest just brief comments. These were just feedback, I think, that Meera would. So, in case you have any just general comments, please, you can take the time to do that. We interact with Rishikesh and Manoj.
I wanted to sort of Professor Chandran, the points she made, those are really interesting points, and I will be trying to integrate them in my research. So I completely agree that with respect to the second point, that it's not only gender, it's not only patriarchy that plays a role in the Indian context. And so in the findings, I look at how class plays a very important role, because these Bengali rural to urban migrant women that I'm looking at, they engage themselves in work as domestic workers in Bengali middle class households. So the sociality between these two groups then leads to a sort of class aspiration to develop, which then intersects with the gender question. And so how that plays out, that is something I explore. And the first point is also something that I've noted down. So thank you very much, ma'am, for the points.
Thanks. Rishikesh, Manoj, either of you, if you have any questions for the judges, or anything else that you would like to talk about.
Hello.
Yeah, Manoj.
Yeah. Right now, I don't have any question, but I have a suggestion. If we continue to celebrate this event every year or twice in a year, so it would be beneficial for every student, because presenting our idea of the research in simple method and within very short time is a very interesting idea. So this is my only advice.
Thank you, Manoj. And it's a student organized event, and we would, in case we have more students who can help us organize this better next year, do join our team as well. This is part of the student meet in January, and I think we'll, the second team for this next year has already been decided, and I think the communication will probably, will be sending out more communication this year, for next year's event. So thank you very much. Yes, we'll try to continue it every year. Rishikesh?
I don't have any specific questions. I just want to thank you for giving us the opportunity, and I really enjoyed the program. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And thank you very much to the judges for taking the time out today and judging this competition. As you highlighted, it's not an easy task. We are glad that people who've already immersed themselves in research and who had experience were able to judge this event and give such valuable feedback. So thank you very much, both of you. And thank you to the participants for engaging.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Yeah.
Thank you.